16th verse. Lord Krishna says, the false never really exists, and the real is never absent for even a moment. The significance of this statement, when we reflect a little bit over it, is that the false seems to exist, but actually it does not. That first part, that it seems to exist, is not spelt out here. Only when we take that much as implied, then the statement, the false never exists, becomes meaningful. That which seems to exist never really exists. And it goes very well with how he began, Ashochyan Anvashochastvam. That which is causing sorrow to you is asat, and it doesn't really exist. Therefore, it is an illusion which is the cause of all this misery. It is not reality. And in the same way, the second part too, sat, which you may imagine does not exist, actually always is. All of you surely have read or heard of that famous narration, which is sometimes put like a poem, where someone has a vision. His footsteps and God's footsteps are seen, and at different time points. It's a vision with a certain message. Over a few years, he sees, God's two footsteps, my two footsteps are together here. We were walking together by the seashore. And in between, for a few years, there are only two footsteps. And thereafter, again, there are the four footsteps. So the man, or it could be lady, wonders, what were those particular years when there were only two footsteps? And he discovers that those were the years when he had the most difficult times. And he jumps to a conclusion, this is most unfair. During my hardest years, God let me down. Those are my steps. And he laments, he complains, how could God do this? When God whispers in his ears, Bache, my child, those two footsteps are not yours. Those two footsteps are mine. And during your hardest times, I was carrying you in my arms. Therefore, there are only two steps. So you imagine that there was no God at that time. Then you discover, no, there was no time and there was no God. Na bhavo vidyate satah. God never leaves us. Truth never leaves us. We, in our misunderstanding, imagine that we are away from God. Once more, we may connect the statement, if you are hurt, something is wrong with you. We imagine everything is wrong with the world around us when we are hurt. This world is so cruel, so ungrateful, and so on. But from the higher spiritual point of view, The world is our own projection and we have a misunderstanding. Something is wrong with us and it is getting reflected over there as the terrible world. Tattva darshis, those who see truth clearly, antaha ubhayoho anayoho, of both these, meaning asat and sat, drishtaha, they see. Therefore, the appeal is, please see properly. All Vedanta is summarized in these two alphabets, B and C. B is Sat and C is Chit. B, we are so drawn to becoming. We do not like to just be. Vedanta says be and don't get caught in becoming. You will become whether you try or not. But when you are trying to become, it is only pain. It causes conflict. Be and see. The alphabet C, but when you pronounce C, you may see that it is also S-E-E, C. The Lord, especially in these selected 20 verses, is only doing this job, helping us to see. These 20 verses, let us put it once more in this way, are Jnana Kanda. They are not about karma. Bhagavad Gita does not talk about karma kanda in the sense of rituals. But as you know, the Gita talks quite a bit on nishkama karma, karma yoga. But these 20 verses are not karma yoga at all. All these 20 verses are focused on Jnana Yoga. And what is Jnana Yoga? It is all about seeing rightly. Samyak Darshana. See rightly, problems are solved. Swami Chinmayananda used to say, Vedanta does not solve any of your problems. And then would add, it dissolves your problems. It dissolves your problems in the sense you discover that there is no problem. Vedanta does not chase away the snake. It helps you see that there is no snake. How are we to drive away, chase away, or beat up, kill the snake and so on? There is no snake. So, the I, which is the center, which is that which supports fears, desire, anxiety, this I dissolves. In the following verses, you may see even more clearly that there is no injunction. That's the technical word, vidhi. A whole lot of religious texts tell you what to do and what not to do, do's and don'ts, vidhi and nisheda. That is the karma vibhaga, the discipline of work. In jnana vibhaga, in the discipline of wisdom, it's not at all about doing or not doing. What am I to do is a wrong question there. What should I do is a wrong question there. Only right question is, what is it? I want to understand. Yes, see properly. And when you see properly and you understand, then you would do the right thing. The should goes away, you would do. If you see that there is only a rope, you would laugh and walk away. And as long as you don't see the rope, you are wrongly seeing the snake. What's the use of telling, should I run or should I stay, should I face it boldly, should I take somebody as help? 100 questions are all meaningless, for there is no snake. Lord continues, avinashitu tad viddhi.
Avinashitu tad viddhi.
Yena sarvamidam tatam.
Yena sarvamidam tatam.
Vinasham avyayasyasya.
Vinasham avyayasyasya.
Nakaschit kartum arhati.
Nakaschit kartum arhati.
Avinashitu tad viddhi.
Yena sarvamidam tatam. Vinasham avyayasyasya. Nakaschit kartum arhati.
Antavanta ime deha.
Antavanta ime deha.
Nityasyokta sharirinah.
Nityasyokta sharirinah.
Anashino prameyasya.
Anashino prameyasya.
Tasmad yudhyasva bharata.
Tasmad yudhyasva bharata.
Antavanta ime
deha. Nityasyokta sharirinah. Anashino prameyasya. Tasmad yudhyasva bharata.
The word here is viddhi, not kuru. Viddhi means please know, please understand, which is result of seeing. Please see rightly. See rightly, then you will understand, then you will know. But you may say, grammatically speaking, the second shloka has the injunction as though, yudhyasva, please fight. Many people hurriedly read Bhagavad Gita and then close it, got it. What did you? The message of Bhagavad Gita is fight wherever you get a chance. Fight, yudhyasva bharata, mil gaya sandesh. Of course, that is a wild exaggeration, but leave alone wherever you get a chance and all that. Even to Arjuna, the message of the Gita was not fight. The fighting is incidental, because that happened to be his duty there. So, improve the language. It is not fight, it is do your duty, being free of likes and dislikes. Sometimes it may be to fight, sometimes it may be to not fight. Sometimes in our case it may be to speak up. Whether we like it or not, we need to speak up at times. Some other time our duty may be to keep silent. Then again Bhagavad Gita would say, whether you like it or not, keep silent, keep mum, keep your mouth shut. So do your duty. This is for Arjuna. But then digging deeper, if you were to study the Gita even more closely as a advanced student, as a qualified student for Moksha Shastra, then the even deeper message of Bhagavad Gita is not even about doing duty, it is only about right seeing. Therefore, for Adi Shankaracharya, Bhagavad Gita was no other than Upanishads restated. And one of the Dhyana Shlokas says it also, Sarvo Upanishado Gavaha Dugdham Gita Amritam Mahat. I am taking only two lines. If the Upanishads are the cows, Gita is the milk. And Upanishads are not scriptures that give you Vidhi and Nisheda. They give you only Jnana. So for Shankaracharya or for anyone who is seeing from that higher point of view, provided the person is qualified also, the Gita is a message of Jnana. But for larger number of people, and to us also most of the times, for our mind also is clouded at most of the times. Then as Mahatma Gandhi put it, as Bal Gangadhar Tilak put it, and hundreds of others put it, it is Karma Yoga. For Mahatma Gandhi, Bhagavad Gita meant Anasakti Yoga, which means the beautiful science of discharging our responsibilities, doing work with no selfish interest. Asakti there means selfish interest, selfishness. So selfless activity. And then for only utterly gross-minded people, it is justification of war and violence and so on. Once in a while we meet people who say, we don't understand why you study Gita. It is basically wrong for Krishna to advise Arjuna to fight the war. Violence, outright violence and so on. So they have not understood the Gita at all. They have seen it very, very peripherally. If they get into the Gita, they will see it's not about fighting the war. That was, we say, incidental. And if you see the story of Mahabharata also, much effort was put in to avoid the war. And Sri Krishna himself went as the representative of Pandavas. He was arrested and Duryodhana tried to keep him in prison, which was not to be done for messengers. You cannot show or take out your anger with messengers. That is Rajadharma. But Duryodhana violated that Rajadharma also and tried to penalize a messenger that Sri Krishna was. Of course, Sri Krishna easily escaped, freed himself. So all attempt or effort was put in to avoid war. And then as the circumstances of those times demanded or commanded, the war became inevitable. The Bhagavad Gita was not at all in the context of deciding about the war. That decision was already taken. That was already a finished exercise. Now, against the backdrop of his duty being defined already, how to go about it? And then as a spiritual text, it is completely about the attitude, about the right way of seeing one's own work. Avinashitu tad viddhi. Therefore, this Yudhyasva in 28th shloka, though it is injunction, it is utterly secondary here. Therefore, I would translate it not so much as Arjuna, here you have fight. Someone may say, you should fight. But as I have commented a while ago, a couple of times, I would take liberty to translate this Yudhyasva here. Therefore, Arjuna, you would fight, not should. Kya karu mai? What would be the logical answer? Ye karo, in Hindi grammar. But instead, you say, tum ye karoge. Would be like that. Don't ask me what you should do. I'm telling you, you will be fighting. If you see rightly, you will be fighting. No one needs to say then. Therefore, you have a powerful statement of J. Krishnamurti. Seeing is action. He doesn't even say right seeing leads to right action. If you put it that way, it is as though there is a little gap. Because when you say something leads to something else, maybe via some corridor or through a road, when you say go this way, this will lead to Abu Road, then there is a distance to be covered. Krishnamurti, very typical of his certain profound way of going about things, would not admit or would not permit a gap. He would say, seeing is action. What he means is, when there is right seeing, there is right action. Whatever you may, maybe to make it a bit easier to understand, when Vivekananda was sent by Ramakrishna to the Kali temple, Vivekananda was, of course, that time he was only Narendranath Datta. He was very worried or anxious about a lot of financial problems that his family had. His father, what was his name? Vishwanath Datta. So Vishwanath Datta, who was a lawyer, was otherwise well placed. They were a reputed family in a sense. But as you know well, sometimes most prestigious families also run into financial troubles. Many times the society doesn't know. They keep it secret also. Only those who are in close touch with them, those who have lent them money, know. So Vishwanath Datta and family were in deep trouble, and Narendra was highly disturbed. Personally, he wanted to quit everything and go with Sri Ramakrishna. But looking at the conditions of his family, he had a conflict. How can I leave my father and mother in such circumstances? So he poured out his difficulties before his guru. And the guru smiled and said, "There's no problem, just go ask the mother. In a jiffy, she will solve all your problems." So he goes. He goes with all intention, with all sankalpa, willpower. The limitations of willpower are illustrated there. He has, before stepping in, he has decided, "I will pray for wealth, for clearance of all loans that my family has." Maybe he has rehearsed it also 3 times. But as he goes and stands before Mother Kali, he just looks at her. He forgets completely. So what is the use of the should? I should do this, I should do that. He just prays for Viveka, Vairagya, Bhakti, comes out. And Sri Ramakrishna asks, "Did you pray for financial solutions?" "Forgot." "No problem, mother won't mind if you go second time." Dubara, Tisri bar, he goes again, asks for Viveka, Vairagya, Bhakti. He doesn't ask for material. So this illustrates, you and I also are like that. Why all this big Vivekananda example? So many of us sincerely decide to get up early at 4 a.m. At 10 p.m., we look at the alarm clock very lovingly. And the only question is 4:30 or 4? 4 or 4:30? Sometimes we are a little sympathetic to ourselves, 4:30, we set it. Some other times for 4. So the question is, should I get up at 4:30 or should I get up at 4? And you answered also. But then the shoulds go into thin air. You would get up at 6:30. Because what operates finally is the reality, your habits. In this case, your habits, your condition, your state of consciousness. Morning, when the alarm rings, the same person who saw it so lovingly is angry with it. why are you disturbing my sleep? Many people hit the alarm clocks. And when it breaks, later they tell people, no, it fell down and broke. they have taken their anger out at the alarm clock. I don't know whether the point is clear. The should is an illusion. Would is the reality. Therefore, in Jnana Yoga, they laugh at Karma Yoga. In one of the places, Adi Shankara says in his commentary on the Gita, Ajnanameva Karma Yoga. Karma Yoga is meant for ignorant people who still believe that things are in their hands, who do not know that a higher force is operating, or first of all, their own habits are operating. Those who believe in choice, those who believe in, you know, all the self-development literature, the big industry, millions of dollars are made in that, you know, industry, based on this illusion. Everybody believes that they can change. So, these management gurus and other writers, popular writers, write so many how-to books. Nobody changes. Workshops are conducted. No one changes. You may say, no, no, I know one person who changed after attending that workshop. To that my response is, that person would have changed otherwise also. That workshop was just a nimitta. It was just, he was anyhow going across the boundary. You know, he was a fence sitter. There was a certain build-up in him. He was about to change. And yes, you know, you would anyhow do. But on the basis of that illusion that I can do, I will do, it's a great hope. All this literature thrives. Seriously, many Vedantins openly criticize this self-help literature. Why do they criticize? Because they see that it extensively draws from the, what do they call it, the sense of, there's another word for it, but it, you can put it this way, sense of I. And especially Western or the modern civilization, modern culture is so much based on sense of I. The metaphysical spiritual wisdom of the East, at least, you know, not that Easterners are following it, that we had in the morning. The I do, I am the doer, is not given much importance or encouragement. In Bhakti Bhasha, it said God is doing, or in Jnana Bhasha, in the language of wisdom, it is said, if your outlook changes, then you would change. Whereas most of self-help literature is not so much about outlook. It highly, you buy those popular books. You know, I also read them once in a while because they are nice, what you call, time pass. I refine them for later on with the sprinkling or I modify it according to the wisdom of the Vedanta. They are highly based on, this again I am looking for some word, not getting it, that sense of it's in your hands, do it, tomorrow do it in another way, right? It presumes the individual's, in Vedanta we call it kartrutva, kartrutva bhoktrutva, right? Huh? Doership. You may say doership, but there was some other word also. So please look at this yudhyasva as utterly secondary here. The pure self is indestructible, and the pure self, the Shuddha Atma, is that ground where space and time have no validity. Therefore, there is this powerful expression, yena sarvam idam tatham. Sarvam idam, all this is pervaded. Tatham here is from the verbal root tan, tanoti, to spread, to pervade. Vyaptam, tatham means vyaptam. Avyayasyasya vinasham na kaschit kartum arhati. Nobody can destroy the truth that you are. Only the bodies are destroyed. At this place, Adi Shankaracharya writes, Ishwarahapi, even God cannot destroy you. There's a very powerful line. See, the shloka says, no one can destroy the self with the capital S. And Shankaracharya writes, Ishwarahapi, and then with a comma, he explains, Tasyapi Swatmatvat. Because what we are talking of is that undivided, that Om is undivided. There is no Om, one Om for him and another Om for her and third Om for the lady here. There is only one Om of God also. So what does it mean? God can do everything, you see, he can destroy. It would mean he will destroy himself in the process, which is again not possible. Not that he doesn't want to. That's another explanation there. Swatmani kriya virodat. One cannot act upon oneself. Can your right hand hold your own right hand? Your right hand can hold your left hand. Your right hand can hold somebody else's right hand or the wrong hand. But your right hand cannot hold your own right hand. That is expressed in Sanskrit as Swatmani Kriya Virodat. There is no possibility of action within oneself. Therefore, Ishwarahapi Vinasham Kartum Na Arhati. Dehaha Antavantaha. Chinmayananji put it very nicely. Every body dies, but nobody dies. Deha is body. Every body dies, but nobody dies. So here also we have a dialogue with death, or here we have a dialogue about death. Sri Krishna talks about death. Therefore, I think it was J.P. Vaswani who gave a beautiful talk on death in one of the satsangs, where he said, death is like a sunset. You say sunset, has the sun really set? The same moment where it is sunset at one place, it is sunrise at another place. And from sun's own point of view, there is no sunset at all, nor sunrise. So is the case of death. There is no death really, but it appears that someone has died. And in the same talk, J.P. says, death is like a bridge. You cross the bridge to go to the other bank. And if there is some fog or the bank of river is, or the river is so wide or whatever, people here may not be able to see you that side. You are very much there. You are walking, you are happily going on. Death is like a bridge. Death is like sunset, he said. And therefore, Dehaha Antavantaha, Shariri is Nitya. Shariri is the one who resides in the body. Therefore, everybody or nobody dies. Every body dies. Give a space between every and body. Anashinaha Aprameyasya. Dehaha Antavantaha. This Anashinaha Aprameyasya are adjectives to Sharirinaha. Nityasya Sharirinaha, Anashinaha Sharirinaha, Aprameyasya Sharirinaha. Of the soul which is indestructible, which is eternal, which is immeasurable, of the soul which is thus, the bodies are destructible. The indweller is not. But alas, hardly anyone knows this. If one were to know it, everything changes for that person. Ya enam vetti hantaram. Yaschainam manyate hatam.
Yaschainam manyate hatam.
Ubhau tau na vijanitah.
Ubhau tau na vijanitah.
Nayam hanti na hanyate.
Nayam hanti na hanyate.
Ya enam vetti hantaram. Yaschainam hanyate hatam.
Ubhau tau na vijanitah. Nayam hanti na hanyate.
Na jayate mriyate va kadachit.
Na jayate mriyate va kadachit.
Nayam bhutva bhavita va na bhuyah.
Nayam bhutva bhavita va na bhuyah.
Ajo nitya shashvatoyam puranah.
Ajo nitya shashvatoyam puranah.
Na hanyate hanyamane sharire.
Na hanyate hanyamane sharire.
Na jayate mriyate va kadachit. Nayam bhutva bhavita va na bhuyah. Ajo nitya shashvatam puranah.
Na hanyate hanyamane sharire.
Terrific poetry also. In the original, when we read it, Lord Krishna indeed is in a very inspired state of mind. He is supposed to be always inspired, so we can say he is more inspired than ever before here. They say he was in a yoga rooda sthiti. You may have heard later on, I guess after the war also was over or so, Arjuna asked Lord Krishna, sorry, please don't mistake me. You gave a wonderful discourse to me on the first day. But you see, that time because of all this pressure, the times were such, I could not fully grasp it. But it was so wonderful. Do you mind giving that discourse again to me? And Sri Krishna said, golden words cannot be repeated. Sri Krishna, I believe, admits that, you know, even if I want now, I cannot say that now. But yet, out of great love, Lord Krishna had such love for Arjuna. He attempts and he says a few things, and that is called Anugita. There is some Anugita. But that doesn't have the same grandeur as this Bhagavad Gita. It is so what with Lord Krishna, it is so with many of us also. In certain charged circumstances, we speak or do or sing or dance or 100 things we do. It just happens. The best things happen. The best things are not done by willing it. Best things happen when we are not even conscious of what we are doing. It surprises others and it surprises us also, even as we talk or sing or whatever, in our own fields. When best things happen at our hands, we ourselves are surprised, and later we admit before our close friends, I really don't know how it happened, but it just came out so well. Whatever it is. It need not be a big speech or a long song. Sometimes it is even just one word. A dhaku comes before you and says, Nikalo, otherwise I kill you. And you had not expected the dhaku. Your diary has no entry, meeting with dhaku at 10 a.m. No such thing. Dhaku means lutera. That's also Hindi. What is? Robber. A robber with a knife has come And sometimes it so happens you are not known to be a soldier or a retired soldier or any such thing, but all the same you may say to the Daku, you are going to kill me, try, I don't fear you, you may say. And the Daku is surprised, he may just go away. Such things have been reported. Somebody very ordinary has said it. Later she herself says, I don't know how that came out of me. One principal of some school in Bombay told me, she was a devotee. What school? Some South Indian school in Sayan or somewhere, that lady. Some of you know her. SIS teacher. SIS, yeah. Right, that lady. She said some people came, I think they were asking for admission of a child, and they even threatened her, don't admit this child, something like that, some pressure they put on her. And she herself says what went through her, she didn't know. There was picture of Swami Chinmayananji there, with hands at the feet of Swami Chinmayananji, she saluted Gurudev and said to that Gunda, do whatever you want, kill me if you like. But at no cost I am going to agree. And that fellow got very confused because he had rehearsed a different dialogue. I will say this, then she will tremble, then she will say, where should I sign, what should I do? So he had planned the whole thing. But this went totally in a different way. He said, okay, I'll come again. This disappeared. And he never came again. So she narrated it once and said, I don't know. Now another day, if a daku comes again, a gunda comes again, there is no guarantee that she would again, it's not through memory. Okay, last time how did it, I held the hands like this. If she tries to do that, she will be a total failure. So all this goes to show that the usual notions of learning, what should I do in such a circumstance, let me read some self-help book. It has given, in chapter 3 is about how to face husbands, and chapter 4 is how to handle neighbors. I will read it again, revise, and I will prepare. This is how self-help books give you some promise. It doesn't work like that. Finally, when the husband does what, suppose it is a problem like that, then you will be trying, wait a minute, what did the book say? One lady complained to me about her husband. She is a devotee of Lord Satyanarayana. She does a Satyanarayana puja and prepares this prasad. And her husband comes and eats it. And when she says, for God's sake, don't eat it till the puja is over. This is for God. And he grins and says, am I not your God? She feels like giving him one. So she has not solved that problem yet. She came to me, I said, I have no experience in this field. Actually, I don't solve anybody's problems. But I have a reputation for solving lot of problems. But my own confession I'll make. I only listen and say, really? Yes, yes. And then the visitors say to me, we took lot of your time, and they go away. Then next day they say, your guidance was very helpful, our problem is solved. And I wonder, what was the problem in the first place? And how did it get solved? It is most mysterious. Ascharyo Vakta. The shloka will come, you know. Again, you see, I had decided not to give out my secrets. See, that shows willpower doesn't go very far. Aapko jo kehna, what do you say that? Jo kehna tha, wo aa jata hai. However much you decide. And something else you want to say, you forget at the time of need. At the time of need, you forget. What is it I wanted to say? You don't. And what you decided not to say, it just comes out. beautiful poetry, ya enam vetti hantaram, anyone who thinks that the pure self is a killer, or in a larger sense, is a doer, or yaschainam manyate hatam, anyone who imagines that the pure self can be acted upon. In grammatical language, we say the subject or the object. You see, when I see television, I am the subject that sees. Television is the object that is seen. When I drink Coca-Cola, Coca-Cola is the object, I am the subject. Karta and karma. The self is neither the karta nor the karma. All of us have done enough exercise in grammar. Kartari prayoga and karmani prayoga. Krishna beats a cat. What is the passive voice of it? A cat is beaten by Krishna. So in the class, the teacher said, I made a mistake. What is its passive voice? And the girl said, I was made by mistake. Passive voice though, it is passive voice. But it is not passive voice of I made a mistake. But that is also not an act of will, it's a reflection of one's learning, one's state of consciousness. If you are learning, if you are samskaras, if you are prior conditioning is like that, that is the kind of answer you will give. However much you may decide, today I will be very careful. But aap jante hi nahi, to kya careful hone ke kya matlab hai? Aap grammar jante hi nahi, you will give that kind of answer. Hatam is killed or acted upon. Hantaram is killer or one who acts. Karma and karta. Ubhau tau na vijanitaha. Both these are superimpositions on the pure self, which is neither the doer nor something which someone else acts upon. It's neither the subject nor the object. Nayam hanti na hanyate. This has profound and vast significance. If this is contemplated upon, if you meditate on this, if you make this your own insight, then you will never feel egoistic. Because egoism is nothing but a notion, I am the doer. You are not the doer. And you will never get hurt or you will never feel somebody harmed you, because it says no one can act upon you. No one can hurt you. No one can disturb you. No one can kill you. You are only the witness, you are the Sakshi Bhava, you are, suppose somebody uses, for example, unparliamentary words at you, you will be aware of it fully, but there is no sense of I am insulted. That is function of thought only. It is mischief of thought, thinking. Even Shakespeare said, there is nothing right or wrong, thinking makes it so. That's a saying in some play of Shakespeare. So it has a good bearing on the Vedantic teachings. As applied to this situation, someone scolds me, let us say, abuses verbally, then that may be factual, but I feeling hurt or I feeling low or I feeling miserable or I blaming myself, what misfortune has come my way. Today I have to hear these words from her. Today I have to hear such bad words from this man. In this way, you know, we blame ourselves or we look down at, that is work of thought. It is possible, we mean to say, to hear those words not out of some sleepiness or dreaminess, with full alertness and not react. Again, not react out of willpower, I will not react, but out of this understanding, I am only awareness. Here are these words. These words have been said, no doubt. And yes, she is or he is referring to me, but who is this me? There is no me here. If this you understand by proper inquiry, by proper contemplation, you will understand this. Then it's a very out of the way experience. You don't feel low at all. So when before she became famous, Mother Teresa asked for some help from a shopkeeper in Kolkata, he got so angry and he spat. So his spit fell right on her hand. Instead of getting some 5 rupees, those days even 5 rupees was a lot. 5 rupees girna chahiye tha haath ke upar. But us haath par gira thuk, a spit. But whatever, her love of God or her sense of humility was such, there was no reaction. She took the hand back and said, "That was for me, now for my orphan children give something." She stretched her second hand, other hand. And if I remember right, the shopkeeper for a moment was confused. Oh, what? Oh. Then he realized, what a patience. And he gave some chavanni, some 25 paisa he threw perhaps. But you see, everyone, he has that capacity of staying alert and not taking things personally, either insult or praise. And when that is done out of full awareness, the appropriate and in fact a noble response comes from somewhere. You yourself will be surprised. Oops, I am surprised that I did not get upset. God's grace, something you may say. That is the meaning, na hantaram, na hatam, na jayate, it's not born, na mriyate, it doesn't die. This is almost a repetition or it's a reprint of a mantra in Kathopanishad, as you will see. There it is said, na jayate mriyate va vipaschit in Kathopanishad. The Gita says, na jayate mriyate va kadachit. One or two words elsewhere also are changed, but it's a beautiful pointer. These are all pointers for contemplation. It ever is, it never is not. And the last line again is very poetic. Na hanyate, it's not killed. Hanyamane sharire, even as the body is killed. You don't get insulted. Even though in a third party's eyes you are insulted. Somebody is watching and X comes and throws abusive words at you. The person, the third party looking at it is horrified. How? What am I seeing this? This person is using the worst, ugly words at her. But you, the recipient, will not feel anything at all. That is quite possible. Hanyamane, while being insulted, na hanyate, you are not insulted. You are being insulted from third party's point of view. In reality, from your own inner experience, you are not insulted. This is the power of the pure self, and it's attainable by just simple wisdom. वेदाविनाशिनं नित्यं
वेदाविनाशिनं नित्यं
य एनमजमव्ययम्
य एनमजमव्ययम्
कथं सपुरुषः पार्थ
कथं सपुरुषः पार्थ
कं घातयति हन्तिकम्
कं घातयति हन्तिकम्
वेदाविनाशिनं नित्यं एनमजमव्ययम् कथं सपुरुषः पार्थ कं घातयति हन्तिकं वासांसि जीर्णानि यथा विहाय न वानि गृह्णाति नरोपराणि तथा शरीराणि विहाय जीर्णानि
तथा शरीराणि विहाय जीर्णानि
अन्यानि संयाति नवानि देहि
अन्यानि संयाति नवानि देहि
वासांसि जीर्णानि यथा विहाय नवानि गृह्णाति नरोपराणि तथा शरीराणि
विहाय जीर्णानि अन्यानि संयाति नवानि देहि
वेद मीन्स वन हु नोस विद इज द वर्बल रूट मीनिंग टू नो विद्या वेद or vidwan or vetta, all these words come from it. Veda is one who knows. That is, if you and I know the pure self as indestructible, by pure self we mean our own true nature. I am indestructible, and for heaven's sake don't limit it to just yourself. Together, like the other side of the same coin, know everyone else also to be indestructible. Otherwise, it would be a lopsided Vedanta. After studying Upanishads or all this, now I am very clear. I don't die. What about others? I am not sure. What is their case? That would be a problem. No one dies. Others are as divine as we are. Others also are as lovable and, as we always say, as loving. To love and to be loved is the inner reality. At a moment it may be potential, but finally it is to be realized. Everyone can love, everyone can be loved. No one is unlovable. Sometimes in agitated moments we say about somebody, you know, once somebody said to me about her mother, her father-in-law. I never knew. I thought everything was very fine with that family. So, but one day I came to know that things, everything is not all right. There is some gadbad, mamla gadbad hai. And why should I be curious? But you know, this should doesn't work sometimes. I was a bit curious. I should not have been curious. But still I asked the daughter-in-law, any problem? Then she looked left and right. Anyone is hearing? Anyone is around? No one was around. But then she also felt, she was wiser than me, that these are not things to be told to. Why should we bother Swamiji also? But since I asked, she said, Swamiji, problem is, you know my father-in-law, you also respect him a lot, I see. You also, you know, are many times very Pali with me, Pali with him, Pali, you know, Pali with him, friendly with him, etc. I know, he is highly respected in the society. But then she used this expression. When I hear that expression anywhere else, I remember this Bahu. She said, you see, but the truth is, society doesn't know. You see, how shall I? She spoke very good English. She said, he is one of those people whom it is extremely difficult to love. It's just not possible to love him. So I hope. That is samsara. Gita says, when is that? In another chapter. Dukkhalayam ashashvatam. This world is dukkhalayam. Everywhere it is ghar ghar ki kahani. Everywhere. And the life is like that. All that glitters is not gold. It looks very nice. We meet people and things look very good, but then nowhere anything is good. That doesn't spare these Swamis also. All of you thinking that he is one person who has no problems. I'll take a separate class. That's better. I won't confess in these classes. We'll have a separate confession class. You know. But no. Why should I disturb your peace? You know, if you imagine that I am free of any problem, and if you feel good, at least there is one person. Keep that comfort. Why should I disturb that comfort? You know. Anyway, why did that come? The Bahu said. The daughter-in-law said about the father-in-law, he is one person whom it is very difficult to love, and so on. So it appears to us, this is the problem, you know, everywhere we feel that I can't bear with this person. He gets on my nerve. I can't see her, or I can't, don't ask me to deal with him. This is the same dialogue everywhere, in Africa and America, India and even South Indians are like that. No exception, what I mean is, everywhere it's like that. The, where the self is, the small self, where the ego, and all of us have ego. Who is free from ego? Everybody. And Vedanta is to break new ground. Inquiry. Thank God, the message here is Nasato Vidyate Bhavaha. That unlovability of daughter-in-law or father-in-law or brother-in-law or sometimes the spouse. In many marriages, the spouse himself or the spouse herself. All kinds of, what is that? That French philosopher, Jean-Paul Sartre. Sartre, right? That's how you pronounce, I get. S-A-R-T-R-E. Sartre. He was a great existential philosopher. He defined hell in a simple sentence. Hell is the other person. Once there is another person, hell breaks loose. But of course, for short periods of time, things are good, going good. Is there an expression, hunky dory? Hunky dory is going good, no? Everything is hunky dory. Haath liye haatho mein. You are happy. Khushi. Khushi manao. But no. That is why I don't accept too many camps. I come before you for 6 days and disappear. Otherwise, the hunky-dory relationship will become whatever. But Vedanta assures us, if you inquire, it need not be so. When we live in a worldly way, it is so. Dukkhalayam ashashvatam. When you break, not easy, I agree, but inquire, hit hard, live alertly. Do not take false comfort in just shlokas and mantras. Do not make it another mechanical exercise, repeating some mantras, shlokas, waving your head. And when any real problem comes, run away from that. That would be a serious error. Therefore, like the other day also we said, for a little of what you study, do quite a bit of quiet contemplation, quiet inquiry. To put it in another way, for a little while every day, face yourself. Generally, we face the television, or we face another person, or there is some free time, lift the phone and call somebody. Always. Sometimes in the name of helping somebody. You know, I called you to help him, to help her. All cover up it is. In the name of helping somebody, you actually are running away from yourself. For heaven's sake, for an hour in a day, don't help anybody. You will feel so lonely. You will feel so miserable. You will feel so lost. Then you understand, in the name of helping, counseling or financial, so many ways you and I, you know, help people, I was actually escaping from myself, from my conflicts. Something is bothering me and I don't want to see it, I don't want to understand it. Therefore, I become a member of some organization, member of some, you know, activity. Go and do something, voluntary work. In the process, though there is a lot of politics there, lot of, you know, some problems are there, no NGO is perfect, but I forget my problems and I get other people to blame. You know, that secretary there is very corrupt, but some of us are going and keeping the show. Otherwise, that NGO will collapse. So, we whitewash our ego. I need not elaborate on and on. In umpteen ways, we run away from ourselves, then we get very old, very old, very old. A part in the corner of our conscience, it says, stop this tamasha. Please face yourself. And we say, yeah, one of these days I will face myself. That becomes none of these days. Inquiry requires that kind of, therefore it's called self-inquiry. Inquire into not his corruption or her corruption. Inquire into your corruption. You are corrupt. Corrupt not in financial way. Any duplicity, any cover-up is corruption. You have lost your purity. Double check on that. Without condemning yourself, try to understand the way you are living or talking, then the ground is broken. You will break new ground, then you find asat never was, never is, never will be. Sat is, see, the same Sri Krishna who says dukkhalayam ashashvatam also says everything is that Brahman. Yena sarvam idam tatam, he just now said. Brahman pervades everything. The famous analogy is here, we just now read. Just as a man or a lady changes her old clothes, throws away, vihaya, discards old clothes and goes for navani vasamsi. Vasamsi here means clothes. Therefore, Lord Krishna is called Pitavasaha. Pitambara is also Pitavasaha. Vasaha means cloth. Elsewhere, Vasaha is dwelling. Right? Vasaha. Nivas, Srinivas, residence. That's another word. But here, the Vasaha, Vasaha, Vasasi, Vasamsi. That's the declension, is clothes. Vastrani ityartaha. In like manner, Sharirani vihaya. One throws away old bodies and takes new ones. What about young children who die? It is said that just as sometimes you have some clothes with you which you bought just last week, but you give away. Many times you give away very brand new clothes also, either because your mind changed, or suddenly you start like somebody, and though you bought this piece with great admiration, oh, how nice this is, immediately took it. But within a few days your mind changed, or you like this person so much, give away. And some people these days, that is supposed to be some kind of, there is some word these days. What is that? They have two states of mind. Not schizophrenia. There is one more word nowadays. That's an old regular general word. A medical word has come.
Bipolar.
Bipolar. Yeah. Bipolar. One day this man or lady goes and does so much of shopping. And when spouse or somebody says, do you really need all this? Yeah, of course, yes. ये तो चाहिए ही. दिस वी नीड न्यू कर्टन्स, वी नीड न्यू. दे बाय सो मच एंड नेक्स्ट डे दिस इज ऑक्यूपाइंग सो मच स्पेस, इसको हटाना है. दे गिव अवे. थर्ड डे अगेन शॉपिंग. देयर इज अ बाइपोलर बिहेवियर. एनीवे दैट इज नॉट necessarily connected here. I was explaining death of a young child. The point is there is no need for clothes to stay with you for 10 years or 3 years or 2, whatever. There is no fixed time. Second day you may give it away. And same way sometimes because of sentimental value you keep a sari for years and years. And sometimes your son, daughter, typically daughter or you know, others make several attempts to throw it away. They throw also sometimes, but you collect it and bring it back. People wonder, why are you keeping this? Mama, throw it away. You know, you don't understand. Then they become suspicious. Who gave this to you? Oh, the man who loved you in college? Michelle's story you heard yesterday. Whatever. You show anger. Don't be too mischievous. I am not going to throw this away. So that sari or that mundu or some dhoti, men also, we are all in the same boat. We keep some old cloth for so long. That explains why some people live many, many years, 107 years. And they don't die at all. So it goes well. This metaphor is just perfect. Vasamsi, so jirnani doesn't mean literally old. It's just an example. Just as some clothes are thrown away and new ones are taken, bodies are thrown away, the soul takes new one. But mind you once more, Sri Krishna is not talking about the transmigrating soul. He is like Nachiketa. He is talking of one level further down. There are three levels, right? There is a pure self which is homogeneous, which has no sin, no merit, does not accumulate anything. It is Satchit Ananda. Then there is a grosser level, Sukshma Sharira, subtle body. Then there is the gross body. So this shloka literally applies to both. But Lord Krishna's primary concern is not this subtle body which throws one gross body and takes another. Within the subtle body, as the enlivening principle, as that truth which makes the subtle body function, there is the pure Satchidananda Atma. This whole 20 verses are not about a soul that survives the clinical death. The message here is a soul that is subtler than even the subtle body, which never changes. See, the word avyaya is there, whereas the sukshma sharira is not avyaya. It is happy sometimes, unhappy at other, weak sometimes, strong sometimes, afraid sometimes, courageous and confident at other times. Mind, indriyas, pranas have a lot of changes in them. So we have three levels of existence, the physical level and the subtle mental, emotional, intellectual, pranic level. And the Vedanta is about even subtler level of the pure self, which has no variation whatsoever. No variation. Avyaya, literally. Utterly changeless. The next two shlokas also are most famous. We'll take them up tomorrow. Om Shanti 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 Harihi Om Shri Gurubhyo Namaha Harihi Om.